We're talking about the Oscars on this episode of Kultur'd. What is up, everybody, and thank you for joining me for another episode of Kultur'd, episode 12. We're doing good. Let's keep it going. If you haven't already, please like and subscribe to this channel. Hit that bell for notification of new, every time I start talking, I get gas. I don't know what's happening. Excuse me. What was I saying? Oh, yes. If you're just joining us, like and subscribe to the channel. Hit that bell for notification. Share. I mean, I think I say a few interesting things. So yeah, definitely share this podcast. We're trying to get the numbers up. I'd like to thank all of the subscribers who have joined the channel since we started. Let's get into it. How are you? What's going on? Today is Easter Sunday. I'm spending it at home being a heathen. You know what? I just found out that I'm actually good at something. Yesterday, I went roller skating, and it was really fun. Now, mind you, I haven't been roller skating since middle school. I was kind of scared because, you know, my knee isn't the best. I played basketball a couple weeks ago, and my knee, I walked onto the court, and my knee started hurting. But, it was fun. It was fun going to the roller rink. It was a friend's birthday. Let's put it this way. I'm good at roller skating forward. Once you get out there with people that roller skate all the time, no contest. There's people roller skating backwards. There's people spinning on their tippy toes. There's different types of roller skates. Apparently, if you're a professional roller skater, you have custom skates. And they're dress shoes with small-ass wheels nailed onto them. Like, I saw a dude with uncle roller skates on. He had on Sunday church shoes with small wheels nailed to them. You gotta get them shit shined. Oof. I even saw a dude with Jordans, Air Jordans with wheels on them. I was like, my goodness. These people take this seriously. I do feel that when you do anything, when you're involved in any activity and there's someone or some people that are good at it, there are snobs in every hobby. I met this one person who had these professional skates, as I mentioned, and I asked her, I said, would you call yourself a skate snob? She was holding her head up like this. She was like, what do you mean, skate snob? I am not aware of this pretentious title that you've bestowed upon me. And I said, yo, are you a skate snob? Like, if I showed up with regular-ass skates that you rent from the skating rink, you know, with the big wheels and the big knob on the front to prevent you from falling mouth first, would you judge me? And she was like, well, no, of course I would not judge you as a person, but I must admit that if I saw you wearing skates like that, I would assume that you were a beginner. And I was like, yeah, you're a skate snob. Don't be ashamed. You're a skate snob. You're good at skating. And you think you're better than people that don't. I get it. different speeds on the in the skating rink. Like the out, you see, these are the rules that you don't know when you don't skate. These are the rules. So the outside rink obviously is where the faster skaters are, and the inner rink is where the slow skaters are, or the people that don't skate at all. So there's actually a center in the middle of the skate rink where people just stand there or they dance. So if you want to dance like on roll bounce, you go to the center of the skating rink, right? And there's a dude there, he wears like a Foot Locker jersey, that his job is just to skate and make sure that everyone keeps moving, right? So he goes around and he has a whistle that he blows when people are stopped or whatever, and he puts his arms out and makes sure people don't get hit or there's no fights or anything like that. But then when he's not saving the world, he goes to the center of the skating rink and he like dances with other. It's amazing. I was doing pretty good until I realized I was going too slow. I was on the outer rink and people were like whizzing past me and pushing past me and all that stuff. I said, God damn. I'll definitely go back. I'll definitely go back to the skating rink. Enjoy it. This weekend, the 13th through the 16th, April 13th through the 16th, if you're listening in Vancouver, I will be at the House of Comedy, April 13th through the 16th, in Vancouver, British Columbia. So if you're in Canada, if you're in British Columbia, Vancouver, and you want to come, there's one show on Thursday, two shows Friday and Saturday, and I believe one show on Sunday. So yes, I will be at the House of Comedy, April 13th through 16th. All right. Let's get into this. Now, I know I'm late on all of these topics. This is actually something that I wanted to talk about for a while. But I want to talk about the Oscars. And I really don't want to talk about like the Oscars like the Oscars of this year. I want to talk about this entire institution that is the Oscars. I mean, I don't have anything against the Oscars per se. I don't have anything against the Academy per se. I mean, as a content creator and a filmmaker, you realize that these are the institutions that you have to collaborate with to realize your dreams to a certain extent. Or it's like a social club that you need to appease to be able to work freely. Which to me is the reason there's so much abuse in Hollywood in the first place. Because it's very... They really try to keep people in their P's and Q's, which is fine, I guess. I mean, if you have a job, there's a certain amount of... there's a code of conduct that you have to follow. But every year, when the nominations come out for the Oscars, it seems that, like, black creators are always shocked when it doesn't turn out the way that they feel it should. And I like when it comes to creating content, when it comes to writing and stuff, I like creating things that come from the heart, not things that I feel that people want to hear. You see, growing up Jehovah's Witness, I'm very sensitive to cult-like behavior. Right, and a lot of things what happens and people there like within the organization, they're actually doing it daily. They deny this, but the truth of the matter is that when you're instructed through repetition, constantly, you don't realize that the decisions you make are in conjunction with what other people expect of you. So instead of you making a decision based on your own personal what's the word? Your own personal motivation. Sometimes we act on fear of retaliation. You know what I mean? Or fear of punishment. You know, that's how law works. You know, the reason that people don't kill each other all the time is because of the fear of losing their freedom. Right? It's not necessarily because they're good people. You know, it's not necessarily because they care about other people's lives. It's because they don't want to deal with the aftermath. And I think people, I think now in 2023, I think institutions are well aware of that. For example, growing up Jehovah's Witness, there's certain instructions and talks that are said over and over again, repeated. Repeated over and over again, so you start regurgitating it, right? When we move over into news media, for years, there's different points that are regurgitated over and over again. Now social media, regurgitate it over and over again. So what happens is that we start repeating what we hear over and over again, and we think that's our own beliefs, right? That's kind of like what the movie Inception is about. You know, they go into the subconscious and they plant an idea so deep so that the person that they plant the idea in is fooled to think that it's their own idea. Right? So when we move into this idea of the Oscars, which is the culmination of the debauchery that is the film industry, and all of a sudden we walk into this theater where millions of dollars has been invested, many different people, you know, dressed in Louis Vuitton and Gucci and, I don't know, Armani suits. Because there's so much money around, people assume that there's this prestige that comes with it. And if anything goes out of line, then all of a sudden that person's a disgrace, right? And when I watch the Oscars, or when I hear, because I don't, to be honest with you, I don't really watch the Oscars. I don't watch the Oscars. When you think about when it's not just, I'm not talking about like the Will Smith slap. I'm talking about how people think that people need to act within the walls of this institution. Now, I feel that it's very critical of Black people that are invited to this event, because I feel that they feel that they're doing Black artists who have put in the work, who have created the content, who have written the scripts, shot the movies, a favor for allowing them to be there. It's the same thing with the Golden Globes. Because at the end of the day, the institution is borderline elite supremacists. And Black Americans specifically, we're not really a part of the elite except for a small few. And I think that speaks more to the industry as a whole than just the Academy. Because if you're Black and you live in Los Angeles for a while and you try to work in entertainment, it's very off-putting. Especially when you're kind of trying to do your own thing, or you don't subscribe to certain things, or you don't want to be involved, or you don't want to waste time or be around. It's very discouraging. Excuse me. It's very discouraging to try to make it in an industry like this. And it's funny, because the thing that's confusing about trying to make an industry like this is that every day people treat you like you ain't shit. And then when you go home, you're like, oh man, I ain't shit. They go, oh no, don't think that about yourself. No, you should always be positive. Positive vibes only. And it's like, yeah, but you tell me I ain't shit all the time. Why don't you change? And maybe I wouldn't feel this way. So every time, you know, the nominations and the Oscars come out, I mean, it's like one of those, you know, it's goofy. But, you know, I will say that I'm happy a movie like Everything Everywhere All at Once has a chance to actually win Best Picture. I enjoyed the movie quite a bit. It's good to know that as far as creation is concerned, we're allowed to be a little bit more experimental when it comes to films that we create and content that we create. Was Everything All at Once like a political push? Probably. I mean, Stop Asian Hate was a big deal. You know what? Let me actually check something. Because Stop Asian Hate was 2022, right? And then they passed the Stop Asian Hate bill in Congress. And then we got Everything Everywhere All at Once. Now, the movie was a good movie. I'm not saying that. The movie was a fantastic movie. So it's cool that one. I'm glad that Short Round won an Oscar. That was cool. Michelle Yeoh won an Oscar too, right? I think Sefti Sue Show won an Oscar, but let's see. 2018 Oscar winner, Best Picture, right? Okay, so. All right, let's do this. Let's go on Wikipedia. Look up Academy Awards. And see, because I think a lot of this stuff has to do with politics. Do. 2027. Let's see here. Come on, Wikipedia, why are you so annoying right now? Oh my God, how are you? Talk amongst yourselves while I try to find best. Look, I'm just looking for Best Picture. Okay, here we go. 94th. Let's see, Will Smith won last year. 2020, Nomadland won that year too. So another Asian director, Chloe Zhao, who won last year? Coda won last year. Deaf. I haven't seen Coda, actually. Steven Spielberg got nominated last year, too. Nomadland, 2021. So that was George Floyd year, 2020. 2019, Parasite won. That was a good movie, too. 2018, Green Book won. That one beat Black Panther and Black Klansman. What was interesting about that year, and this is what I'm saying about, see, this, okay, so this is a classic example of what I'm saying when they talk about the respect that's deserved, or the respect you're supposed to show. So that year, what's his face won? Spike Lee won for Best Adapted Screenplay, right? But Spike also wrote that script, but like four other people. Well, three other white dudes. And it is what it is, but it's one of those things where for years, Spike had always tried to be the guy that's like, you know, I don't give a fuck about the Academy. I'm going to make my own movies. Don't fuck with me anyway. You know, fuck you and fuck Quentin Tarantino, right? And, you know, he has a Brooklyn attitude. But when people hear him talk, he sounds annoying to them. To them, oh, this guy's always complaining. Then, you know, I think Quentin Tarantino and Spike Lee have like the same bravado when it comes to actually speaking in interviews and stuff like that. They have very strong opinions. They have they're unwavering in the things that they say. And I think they're both interesting to listen to, but the one of them definitely gets more respect from the Academy than the other, and that's Tarantino. And Spike Lee has made more movies. So, for Spike to basically be like, yeah, man, I don't need them, I'm gonna do my own thing, and then to win, and then be like, oh, thank you, white people, for finally acknowledging me. It was kind of weird, I ain't gonna lie. And then immediately after that, Green Book to win, and him to be like, man, fuck these white people, and then walk out. And that kind of illustrates, exactly the game that the Academy plays, in my opinion, right? So, man, fuck all this. I just want to talk. So, the Academy and black people. Keep in mind that this is the same institution that when Hattie McDaniel was nominated for an Oscar for playing a maid in Gone with the Wind, they had her wait in the kitchen. They had her wait in the kitchen until they called her name, and then she came out of the kitchen, accepted her award. And the speech that she gave was, like, weird, because her speech was like, I hope that this award brings honor to my race and to the people of America. It was, like, something weird like that. And I'm like, man, fuck that shit. They made you sit in the kitchen next to the potatoes. Fuck that shit, right? But I can understand the pressure because, again, the prestige and the message of it is, bitch, you are lucky to even be invited here. So then there's that pressure where it's like, man, if I don't go to the ceremony, they're never going to let other black people into this thing. Which is a lot of pressure, if you ask me. Where it's like, we're not going to allow you into our cult because you misbehaved. Right? So every year, black producers and content creators watch the Oscars, or the nominations rather, and they're disappointed that their slave movies or black trauma movies doesn't get nominated. And that's confusing for me, because when the movies are produced, or when the movies first come out, you always hear the story of, oh, yes, well, these are just stories that we need to tell so that people can know our history. That's why we make these movies about slaves and Harriet Tubman and the Underground Railroad. And we're going to make a movie about Emmett Till. And we're going to make a movie about, like, the Birmingham race riots. And because people need to know about racism. People need to know about what black people went through to overcome racism in this country. And you're like, okay, cool, all right, yeah, that's, yeah, okay. And then the previews come out for the movie, and you're like, I do not want to go to the movies and get angry. And I have an AMC A-list where I don't have to pay. I don't want to go to the movies and get angry. I want to eat popcorn, and I want to have fun. So I see these movies, and I'm like, well, who are these movies for? Because black people, audiences, were like, look, I don't want to. I know my grandfather was there. I don't need to go and actually, like, watch this stuff. And then white people are like, well, we don't want to watch that either. We want to go see Super Mario Brothers. Like, if I had a choice, if I had a choice between Madea Goes to a Plantation and Super Mario Brothers, I would choose Super Mario Brothers. Which was a fantastic movie, by the way. Fuck what the critics say. So, they make the movies, and they start off by saying, look, we want people to know our history. That's the reason why we made these movies. Black Lives Matter. And then they don't get nominated. And then they go, this industry is so racist that they won't nominate my movie about slavery. I thought you made the movie about slavery so that you could teach us about slavery. I didn't know you were doing it for an award. Damn. If you're going to do it for an award, if you're going to make movies for awards and then they don't get nominated, you might as well just make whatever you want. You better make a nigga in space movie. Or make a movie about black people flying on the back of dragons or something. Or black people traveling through time, because those seem to be the movies that are getting nominated, but they don't got black people in them. They got everybody else. It seems like that the filmmakers that are winning Oscars are making movies that are ridiculously fun. You know? I don't know. It's just, I don't know. I don't like the idea of us trying to fit into this box or be seen as elites or prestigious and stuff, doing stuff that we don't really like just to get titles that don't matter, or they're not going to give them to us anyway. Be creative. Do what you want. That's why I respect a lot of the filmmakers now that are doing their thing, like Jordan Peele and Donald Glover and Quentin Brunson and Issa Rae and others, to name a few. Then they have the gall, when we show up to the awards and not do what they want, to say that we are a disgrace. The Will Smith slap. I think the Will Smith slap raised the ratings of the last Oscars episode, because that's what everyone was talking about. I mean, much respect to Questlove for winning the Oscar for Best Documentary, which happened as an epilogue to the slap heard around the world. But, you know, Will Smith is a disgrace. Will Smith slapped somebody on live television. He is a disgrace. We're going to ban him from the Academy for 10 years. How dare he? I mean, there's two things about that, right? And we already had the conversation about Chris Rock's special, but there's two things about that. The Academy has made it very clear how they feel about Jada Pinkett. Because in 2015, let me check. When did Concussion come out? Concussion. 2015. I'm good. In 2015, 2016, when Concussion was not nominated, and Jada Pinkett Smith came out and said, hey, we should all boycott the Oscars because the Oscars are so white and they don't believe in us and all that stuff and blah 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 and all that stuff, and they're not giving black people a good chance. They hated that. The Academy hated that she said that shit, right? So if you remember, in the 2016, for the 2015 season of movies, the 2016 Oscars, Chris made a joke about Jada Pinkett Smith, and he said, "You weren't invited to the Oscars, so we don't give a fuck about your opinion." And as soon as he said that, he damn near got a standing ovation, you know. And even in that same monologue, he talked about the racism that is in Hollywood. But he did it like tiptoey. He never actually like said Hollywood was racist. He's like, well, it's kind of racist, but like not really. And that material got some laughs, but not as big as the laugh than him telling Jada that she didn't belong. And also keep in mind that was the same year that the Sony Pictures hack leak, the email hack leak came out too. That if you remember, there was some big producers at Sony that were saying racist shit about Barack Obama and Will Smith and all that stuff. And nothing was really said about that. So I'm saying this is the industry. This is the industry that we work in. And if you live in Los Angeles for any amount of time, you know that that's kind of how things are in this city. Like, we have as far as the city's concerned, we're very segregated. We're a very segregated city. So when it comes to this idea of is the industry perpetually racist? Well, I think it has to do more with the elite-ism that is the culture of this city. Because the way it works is there's a hierarchy of people in the industry, right? And if you're trying to make it in the industry, there's procedures you have to follow, and there's things that you have to leave behind, right? And I remember a producer I heard talking. He was talking to a group of us about comedy. And he specifically said that when you're going to audition or when you're going out for another show or whatever, don't take another person with you. Because that person could take your spot, right? Now, I don't know if anybody else was told that. This producer guy happened to be black, and all of us that were in the room were black, right? So I don't know if that's what white people are told, but basically for us to make it in this industry, there's this unspoken competition between us because there's really this myth that people believe that only one black person can be on top at once. That's total bullshit. It's a total lie. If we actually work together, we would be pretty powerful because it's been proven from other groups of friends that have come together creatively. They're all worth hundreds of millions of dollars. But for some reason, we're scared. And even when you work with people, too, and you try to like make it happen, they have like this attitude where they're trying to sun you all the time, or they're trying to make sure that you don't, you know, you don't have one up on them, even though they're not that good at what they do. It's always an ego check. Everyone has ego issues, but that's the type of environment that's being cultivated in this industry. And now even more, when people are trying to push political ideologies, now the elitism is based on beliefs. What do you believe? If you don't agree with what I believe, then you have no room to actually... We don't have room for you on this boat, basically. So there's this pressure that you feel where you have to always say the right things at the right time. Either if you don't, you have to either be quiet or you have to believe something that you really don't, or you have to say that you believe something that you don't just so you can get a one up, right? So it really messes with your psyche. And that's why when you try to meet people or hang out with people or just be normal, it's hard to find people that are normal because they're afraid that they're going to say something or do something that's eventually going to be held against them later in their career. I mean, that's the issue that you have with podcasting, because now we live in a time where everyone just looks for something. And they'll say, oh, this guy's about to do something huge. Let me go back and find something that he said or she said so that we can cancel them, because we really don't like their face. I know it's going to happen to me. I know it's coming. You know, you can clip this. Just something. I said something in 2015 and it's going to come back and get me. So, or I told a joke or whatever. So it's one of those things where it's definitely, they want you to stay in your place. They don't want you to rock the boat too much. Even though they do want you to rock the boat. You see, they reward people that do things differently, but when you're coming up, they want you to try to do things the way that they see fit. So that's why this to me doesn't make sense, right? Now, what I did enjoy, I was kind of annoyed when I say it, but then at the same time, everything that it stood for, to me, I was rooting for, and that is Tim's dress that she wore to the Oscars. Now, Tim, she wore this white gown, leg, she was looking delicious. She was just beautiful chocolate leg out. She had this veil on her that made her look like a white rose or a flower or whatever. The dress was nice, in theory. But in practicality, no, it wasn't. So the controversy is that she sat down and she was sitting in the middle, and her dress, her veil was so big. She didn't take her veil off. Her veil was so big that the man next to her had to lean over like this the whole time, which I would have been pissed. And then there was people behind her who couldn't see because the veil was so big, right? Now, let's just give it for what it is. It was rude as hell. It was rude as hell. It was inconsiderate. Even when Jimmy Kimmel and them were like telling jokes or whatever, right? Like, she barely clapped. Like, she was not excited at all for the ceremony. She's like those women that go to comedy shows that they really don't like comedy, but they go to comedy shows anyway. And then they sit there and they're like, you better make me laugh and all that stuff. But then they don't give you like any energy. You know what I mean? So that's like what she's like. I've seen plenty of her at shows that I've done. So that was the energy she was giving. So like a part of me as like a performer and a comedian, I was kind of annoyed because I was like, yo, like actually like give a fuck about being there. But then at the same time, that's the same mindset that the Academy has, so I'm trying to steer away from that. Because at the same time, I said, I also am down with the fuck you to the institution that you're doing, Tims. This is for Hattie McDaniel having to sit in the kitchen. And this is for Malcolm X not being nominated for an Oscar. Because, you know, liberal Hollywood doesn't really like Malcolm X all that much because he tells black people that they need to do their own stuff and not worry about rude and inconsiderate, but right on time, right? Jonathan Majors came to the Oscars cosplaying as Steven from Django Unchained. I have no idea what, I don't know what he was thinking. I mean, I've worn similar shirts and like that with my suits when I haven't done laundry, but I need to go to church. I don't know who dressed him. He seems like he dressed himself. Angela Bassett should have won. Angela Bassett should have won the Oscar, in my opinion. First of all, I'm just talking. Look, I'm just talking about as far as lifetime achievement was. Because let's face it, the Oscar never goes to the performance that they should win for. It really is like a celebration of their body for of work. Angela Bassett needs to win an Oscar soon. No one was talking about Jamie Lee Curtis winning. Nobody was talking. I mean, okay, so she was very, again, I liked Everything Everywhere All at Once more than I liked Wakanda Forever. I saw both movies twice. Now, actually, I saw Wakanda Forever like six times. But I saw Everywhere, Everything, All at Once twice. And I was blown away every single time. But if we're talking about just body of work, Jamie Lee Curtis did have some range in Everywhere, Everything, All at Once. But if we're talking body of work, Angela Bassett should have done it. I mean, her bottom lip alone deserves an Oscar. You know, she's like, I am the. That quivering bottom lip. I am the queen of Wakanda. I have lost all of my family. Have I not sacrificed everything? And I'm like, oh shit, auntie. That made my nipples hard. You know what I'm saying? Like, yes, I think she should have won an Oscar. Her bottom lip should have won an Oscar along with Viola Davis's Snot Bubbles. I think Angela Bassett should have won an Oscar when she played Michael Jackson's mama. Because she had to act like she had 76 kids. My favorite scene is when Joseph comes home and they leave the towel in the pool, and Joseph's like, I'm gonna give you guys a beating. And Angela Bassett's like, go to bed, Joseph. Go to bed. I mean, Angela Bassett played Michael Jackson's mama, Tina Turner, Biggie Smalls' mama, T'Challa's mama. She played Betty Shabazz twice in two different movies and didn't get nominated for either of them shits. Then people want to get mad at her the way she reacted when Jamie Lee Curtis wins the Oscar. Let that woman be disappointed. Let me show you something. Let me show you how ridiculous this gets. Let me show you how ridiculous this gets. Entertainment Weekly, this is from the comments. Someone said, the best moment of the night had to be watching the sour look on Bassett's face when she lost. Blasphemy. And then someone under that said, yeah, it was the perfect opportunity for her to take the high road, show some class, and appreciate someone else's moment. It was definitely a Kanye moment. Do people have like a measure of how intense moments are? Or does everyone just stay in the house and everything that happens to them is like a jolt or a shock? I also supported Kanye when he interrupted Taylor Swift's speech. Fuck him. Let's see, what else did they say? I haven't seen Everything Everywhere All at Once, but I say Jamie Lee Curtis deserved the statue as a Lifetime Achievement Award, if nothing else. Bassett's reaction was still priceless. It made the moment even more memorable. See? People are talking about Angela Bassett's reaction more than they're talking about Jamie Lee's win. Just like the Will Smith Oscar slap. That's it. That's it. Those are all the comments. But Angela Bassett deserves that Oscar. If it's the last thing I do, I'm going to get Angela Bassett that Oscar. We love you, Auntie. And this has been another episode of Kultur'd.
I don't know if you have heard that in my world.